It's good to see so many of you. My name's Jacqueline Douglas, and I'm an English language teacher and teacher trainer based in Cambridge. Welcome to the webinar on the revised Cambridge English Advanced Reading and Use of English paper. Please note that Cambridge English Advanced is also known as Certificate in Advanced English, or CAE. Let's briefly look at the aims of this webinar. As you can see, the aims are to give an overview of the reading parts of the Cambridge English Advanced Reading and Use of English paper, to identify the reading skills and sub-skills needed by candidates, and to provide ideas on how to help students improve their reading. If you have any questions during the webinar, please ask them in the chat box, and at the end of the session, I'll be joined by Dr. Ivana Vujaković, who is a Senior Research and Validation Manager at Cambridge English Language Assessment, and we'll answer as many questions as we can. Here's a quick outline of this section of today's webinar. We'll begin by considering why we read in real life and what reading involves. We'll then look at what reading skills are assessed in each of the reading tasks in the Reading and Use of English paper. We'll explore ways of helping candidates to improve their reading skills, and some teaching ideas to use in the classroom. Finally, we'll look at what resources are available to you all. Before we start, I'd just like to know how many of you are currently preparing students for the Cambridge English Advanced Reading and Use of English paper. Look at the statements on the screen and use your polling buttons to choose which one applies to you. Oh, I see. So the majority are preparing students for the exam. Some of you are going to be doing that in the future, so this webinar will be useful for all of you and including those who are students. Let's move on to think about what reasons Cambridge English Advanced students have for reading and what their real-life reading needs are. Think about their education and academic life and how they'll need to read at work. Type a few words into the chat box to show why Cambridge English Advanced students need to have good reading skills. Okay, so we have understanding lectures for work, sure, looking at emails, on the academic side as well. Okay, and here are a few reasons why Cambridge English Advanced students need to read. To be able to skim read a text to decide if it's interesting or relevant. This is an everyday skill that our students use when they study or when simply looking for something interesting online. To understand a text in detail in order to learn more about a topic or find information to support their research or help them do their work. Many of our Cambridge English Advanced students are using English in higher education or for work, so this is relevant to a lot of them. To quickly locate information in a longer text, this is another useful skill, particularly for those in higher education or those who have to process reports and such for work. To follow instructions, manuals, recipes, how-to instructions, all these text types are very common online now, and most online content is still in English, so it is likely that our students will come across these types of texts. And finally, let's not forget reading for pleasure. At this high level, it is likely that our students will read books, magazines, or blogs simply for their own pleasure. Now let's think about what reading at an advanced level actually involves. We're going to take a look at a series of texts and questions, and we'll consider what reading skill is required for each. Firstly, let's take a look at a reference book, such as a dictionary or encyclopedia. Obviously, this isn't the sort of thing that we'd read from cover to cover, so what reading skill would you use? Type a few words into the chat box to say what reading skill you'd use when looking at reference books like these. Okay, so we've got a lot of you talking about scanning and reading for specific information. Okay, so in this situation, you need to be able to scan quickly to locate specific information. Now let's look at another type of text. This is someone reading a novel. When reading something like this, what reading skill is involved? Again, type a few words into the chat box to say what reading skill you'd use when reading a novel. Okay, so you're saying reading for comprehension, in-depth understanding, understanding the plot, gist. You're reading extensively. You're reading to understand detailed information, to understand opinions, attitudes, follow events, etc. Next, let's look at a short extract from a text. Take a moment to read it. Here's a question which Cambridge English Advanced Learner might be asked about this extract. And here are three different reading skills. To answer this question, which of these reading skills would be required? Use your polling buttons to choose which reading skill applies here. Most of you have gone for B, which is understanding implied meaning, and the answer is B, as the workplace isn't stated, but you can work it out by implication. Here's another question. This question is asking the reader to understand a particular feature of text structure or organisational structure. What does the reader need to be able to understand in order to answer this question? Use your polling buttons again to choose which reading skill applies here. Okay, the popular choice is C, and yes, the answer is C. The question is about understanding a reference in the text. Now let's look at exemplification and comparison. Here is a very short extract from a novel. Which does it include, an example of exemplification or an example of comparison? Type your answer into the chat box. Okay, so a lot of you are going for comparison there, and the answer is comparison. The author is comparing the difficulty of removing an item on the shelf to playing a game called Jenga. Another skill that Cambridge English Advanced readers need is to be able to recognise a wide range of linguistic devices which mark the logical and cohesive development of a text. Have a look at this list of linguistic devices on the left, and then at the list of examples on the right. They are mixed up. Can you match them correctly? Here are the answers. Other linguistic devices that a Cambridge English Advanced reader needs to be able to recognise as well are, for example, the use of verb tenses to indicate temporal links, repetition, e.g. for emphasis, and referencing. To sum up, there are many sub-skills involved in reading at this level. They include scanning to locate specific information, detailed reading to understand finer points of detail, attitude and opinion, understanding implied as well as stated information, understanding at sentence level and beyond, including how a text is structured, understanding the writer's purpose, and understanding organisational features such as use of exemplification, comparison, and reference. Let's move on to consider what is assessed in the reading tasks in the new Cambridge English Advanced Reading and Use of English paper. So here's a summary of the new Reading and Use of English paper. As you can see, there are 8 parts in total, and the whole paper takes 1 hour and 30 minutes. We're going to look at parts 1, 5, 6, 7 and 8. Part 1 is a multiple choice closed task. Candidates read a short text which has 8 gaps in it. They have to choose the correct word to fit each gap, and for each gap there are 4 words to choose from. Let's have a quick look at an example from a Cambridge English Advanced sample paper, which is about a man studying black bears. This is just part of the text and the question that goes with it. Which is the correct answer? Use the polling button to choose A, B, C or D. Ooh, we have a roughly even split between B, doubt, and C, illusion here. The correct answer is C, under no illusion. So as you can see, the focus in this part is on testing knowledge of vocabulary. This might be phrasal verbs, fixed phrases, as in this example, idioms, collocations, or semantic precision. Although it's in the use of English section of the paper, reading skills are involved, which is why we are looking at this task in this webinar. Parts 2, 3 and 4 do involve some reading, but the overall focus of these tasks is on testing awareness and control of grammar, word formation and keyword transformation. Part 5 is a multiple choice task. Candidates read a longer text and answers 6 multiple choice questions, testing understanding of the gist and detail of the text. This might include testing implied as well as stated meaning, and also testing understanding of text organisation features such as referencing, comparison, and exemplification. Understanding attitude and opinion is also tested in Part 5. This is just one of 6 questions that candidates would have to answer on a text about the internet today. This extract is taken from sample paper 2, which is available on the website. As you can see, each question has 4 possible answers. This particular question focuses on a detail which is repeated throughout the text, so it requires global reading skills. Part 6 is a multiple matching task. Candidates have to read 4 short texts on a related theme. There are 4 questions which take the form of prompts, and they have to match each prompt to one of the texts. However, this is a complex matching exercise in that each prompt relates to the opinions and attitudes expressed in more than one of the texts. So first of all, the candidate has to understand the opinions and attitudes expressed in each text, and then they have to identify how the opinions and attitudes in the other texts are similar, or how they differ. Have a look at an example of a question from the sample task in the 2015 handbook, which is based on 4 different reviews of the same book. To answer this question, candidates have to firstly work out what the opinion expressed in A is, and then they have to identify which other reviewer expresses the same opinion. Part 7 is the gap text task. This consists of a text which has had 6 paragraphs removed and placed in a jumbled order after the text, along with 1 extra. Candidates have to decide which paragraph completes each of the 6 gaps, so the focus of this task is on text structure, cohesion, coherence and global meaning. This task requires candidates to recognise a variety of linguistic devices that connect paragraphs: thematic, grammatical, temporal, lexical, and so on. We'll look at this text in more detail later. Part 8, the final part, is a multiple matching task. Candidates read either one text which has several sections or several separate short texts and 10 questions. They have to decide which text or section answers each question. This task requires effective scanning skills to locate specific information and also tests understanding of detail, attitudes and opinions. Let's move on to consider why and when we read, and how this affects the way we might want to approach reading with our students. To start with, let's think about what we do when we read in real life. There are three sentence prompts on the slide. Could you complete them in the chat box? Okay, so we have, I read another, I talk about it with my family. I posted the link on Facebook, I discuss it with somebody. Thank you. There are lots of different suggestions then coming in. Here are some suggested answers. I read a news article and then tell my partner about it. I read a book and then recommend it to a friend. I read journals and essays and then write an assignment or give a presentation based on my research. As you can see, the reading activity is followed up by some speaking or writing in these examples. You might also listen after or before reading, for example, watch an interview on YouTube with a person you've read about. The point is, we don't usually read in isolation. We read then speak, we listen then read, we read then write, and so on. Think about doing this in class too. Link reading with other skills to reflect how students read in real life. If we can give them a reason to read, they are more likely to engage with it. And reading is important. In the exam, candidates have to read approximately 3,000 to 3,500 words in 1 hour 30 minutes. This includes the text in the use of English parts of the paper. Students at this level need to be able to read extensively and to cope with longer, complex texts. Some teachers think that it's better to get students to do reading for homework because there are more important things to focus on during class time. Let's see what you think. Choose which statement reflects the way you teach your students. Okay, so we've got a lot of you saying C, equal amounts, and I think that's probably equally divided between that and option A, homework. Okay, let's think about reading during class time. Can you think of any reasons why this is a good thing to do? Type a few words into the chat box to say why it's good to focus on reading during class time. Okay, so we've got options talking about timing the students, to work on vocabulary, to show that reading's important, and to help with other difficulties, thinking about motivation. Lots of ideas coming in here. Here are some reasons why it's a good reason to focus on reading during class time. You can make reading more interesting. You can foster enthusiasm for reading. You can develop sub-skills, e.g. working out meaning from context. You can train students to read faster, and you can teach structures and lexis found in a text. We'll take a look at some of these points in more detail in a moment, but first let's also consider why reading can be a good thing to give students for homework. You can give students longer texts to read. There's less distraction at home. Students can use dictionaries or record vocabulary in their own time. Students can take as much time as they want to read a text, and students can bring tasks to class to check. Do you have any other reasons for setting reading for homework? Type them in the chat box now. Okay, so we have individual practice. Students read in their own rhythm. There's not always time in class. Thank you for those suggestions. Now let's move on to think about some more practical ideas on how to do reading activities in class. At this level, students need to be able to read quite quickly, and many of them find this difficult. Do you remember how many words students will have to read in the Reading and Use of English paper in 1 hour 30 minutes? Type your answer in the chat box now. Okay, some of you are saying 3,000, 3,000 to 3,500, which is the right answer. They will have to read between 3,000 and 3,500 words in 1 hour 30 minutes. Let's look at some ideas to help our students improve their reading speed in class. One way of doing this is to give students a longer text. Ask them to start reading, then after a minute, tell them to stop reading and mark where they've got to on the page. Compare how much they've read and ask them to think about what slows them down. It could be things like trying to understand all the details or unfamiliar vocabulary. Tell them not to worry about this when they start reading a text. They can always go back and reread sections in more detail later on. Here's another idea. Give them a text to read and tell them it's a race to get to the end of the text. You should read it too, as fast as you can, and when you've finished, tell them to stop reading and to turn over the page. Then, working in pairs, ask them to tell their partner as much as they can remember. They'll be surprised what level of detail they've picked up. Then ask them if there are any points that weren't completely clear. Elicit one or two points, then give them another minute or two to look at the text again. Find the point they weren't sure about and read it more slowly to clarify meaning. Another technique that helps some students to increase reading speed is simply to tell students to put their index finger on the centre of the first line of a text, and as soon as they start reading, to gradually draw their finger down the centre of the page, in effect pulling their eyes down with it. This can also be used to train students to scan a text, where they're searching for a particular word or phrase, rather than trying to understand all the content. All of these activities work best if you do them regularly. This will get your students thinking about their reading speed. Let's consider some other things that are good to focus on during class time, apart from improving reading speed. Students at this level need to be able to read a wide range of texts, different topics, different sources, and different registers, not just texts from course books. Encourage students to find texts themselves. They can search in newspapers, magazines, leaflets, on the internet, from novels and so on. Have a lesson when each student has to bring in a text. Then, in small groups, each student presents their text to the others, saying why they chose it, what they found interesting or not about it, what they liked or not about it, and what they learned from it. When they have all finished, each student chooses one of the texts they would like to read. They then swap texts, read them, and then spend a few more minutes asking questions, clarifying meaning of language, commenting, and so on. Alternatively, you could have a rota, and once a week a designated student brings in one text and presents it. You could also establish some sort of class book club. If you're running a book club with your students, type in the book you're reading. If you're not, type which book you would like to read with your students in a book club. Okay, Madeline talks about The Outlander, The Invention of Wings, Romeo and Juliet, Great Gatsby, Wonderful, 1984, The Book Thief, Catcher in the Rye. Thank you, some really nice suggestions. A lot of teachers are keen readers, so let's get our students enthusiastic about reading too. A book club can be such a great way of doing that. There are many ways of setting up a book club. The main question is whether all students read the same book or whether students choose their own books. Once you decide this, the rest will follow. We've put some ideas to consider for you on the slide, but there are of course many more. Another way of getting students interested in reading is by choosing different texts dealing with the same topic. There are three suggestions on this slide. Use your poll button to vote for which one you would most easily be able to find several texts. Well, there's no right answer here. you could quite easily find different sources for each of these. For a film review, you could find one in a newspaper and then online, perhaps from a biased source, such as a fan site. A news story you could also find covered in different ways, of course in a newspaper, more in depth in a magazine, or simply discussed on social media such as Twitter. Texts on lifestyle trends you can find in magazines, on social media online, or in blogs. Once you've sourced a couple of texts dealing with the same topic, what would you do with them? Type your ideas in the chat box now. So we've got vocabulary, comparisons, contrast opinions, compare the register. Following on from the previous task, you could ask your students to produce short tasks to pass on to another group. For part 6, they would need to identify an opinion or attitude in one of the texts, then find another text which expresses the same or a different opinion or attitude, and produce prompts such as, which writer shares writer B's opinion about? Again, using paraphrase where possible. For part 8, they need to focus on points that are unique to each text and produce a series of statements such as which text states that or which writer did, using paraphrase language where possible. You could also get students to produce their own closed tasks, similar to the part 1 task in the exam. For example, take a look at task 1 on your handout. You can see the text on the screen too. It's about a woman who became a fisherman. The text is from the complete advanced second edition, adapted from The Hungry Ocean, a Sword Boat Captain's Story by Linda Greenlaw, Hodder and Stoughton. Using your pointers, can you find an adjective-noun collocation in the first paragraph? Think about your Cambridge English Advanced students and which language would be useful to them. Okay, so I can see unique childhood, rare claim. As many of you said, I was looking for a rare claim. Can you find a set phrase in the first paragraph? Okay, we have, I believed wholeheartedly, it was only natural, it might come back to haunt them. I was looking for come back to haunt them. And can you find any verbs that are followed by particular prepositions in the second paragraph? I can see graduated from, moved on, started with. Yes, I was looking for graduated from and postponed for. This sort of language is commonly tested in part 1, so you could, for example, put a gap in the text like this. For part 1, there are always 4 options for each gap. We know the correct word to fill this gap is come, but what could the wrong options be? Type your ideas in the chat box. Okay, we have go, get, arrive, bring. Yes, those are nice ideas, and here's a possible set of options. If you do decide to do an activity such as this in class, you will need to monitor students' work carefully to make sure they are choosing appropriate language, that the words tested are spread out throughout the text, and that there is only one possible correct answer in each set of options. They will need to type their text with numbered gaps for each word they have chosen and a set of options for each gap below. Students can then swap tasks and try to compare them, then either mark each other's work or provide an answer key for self-access. Another thing that is useful to focus on in class is looking at how longer texts are structured, focusing on the linguistic devices that connect paragraphs, for example. This helps candidates with the gap text task in particular, part 7 in the test. Let's look at the part 7 text in the 2015 handbook as an example. It's on the screen, but you also have it as task 2 on your handout. If you were going to show students how to do a task like this in class, you could allow this procedure. Sorry, you could follow this procedure. Tell students firstly to skim read the text but not the options, so they have an idea of the content. Elicit from them what the gist of each paragraph is about. For example, the first paragraph in this text describes a picture the author has of a wildcat. Then tell them that they're going to look at the options and you're going to ask them to look for some possible links with the paragraphs in the text. So for example, you could ask students if they can find anything in the options that refers to what a wildcat looks like. As you can see on your handouts, the link is, "It is a typical image," at the start of option G. So, there is a lexical link between the first paragraph and option G. You could then ask students what sort of link there is between option G and the next paragraph. There is a contrastive link. Option G refers to similarities between wild and domestic cats. The next paragraph refers to the differences. So this is another idea you could try with your students in class. By drawing students' attention to these links and the different types of links that they might find, it will help them to approach this type of task with more confidence. Let's just remind ourselves of some of the ideas for the classroom. You can also find them on your handout. Which one do you think you will use in class next week? Type your answer in the chat box. Okay, so we have a lot of speed reading, book club, the structure of the text. Okay, same topic, different tasks. Thank you. And that's all we've got time for in this session. To sum up, we've looked at why students read and what skills are involved in reading. We've also looked in more detail at each of the reading sections in the Reading and Use of English paper and explored some teaching ideas to help you prepare candidates. I hope you found this webinar useful. If you want further information and ideas for teaching activities, there are plenty of resources available to you. Dr. Ivana Vidakovic and I will answer any questions you have about the revised Reading and Use of English paper. Please type in any questions you have and we'll do our best to answer them. So Ivana and I are here to answer some of your questions. We have a few minutes to do that. If I can begin with a question about a past paper. So this is a new paper that we have here, but understandably already one or two of you are asking about when past papers might be available. We don't actually have that information available at the moment, but what I would advise is that in time you would contact Cambridge Assessment Help Desk and they would be able to field that question for you. So the Help Desk would help you with that one. Another question is on the Part 7, any teaching ideas on this? Basically because there are lots of comments from this morning that it's very difficult and probably one of the most challenging parts of the paper. I think I would have three pieces of advice here. The first one is that students would do well to focus on the whole text so that what they're doing is getting a global understanding of the text initially, and then to look at the cohesion, so how ideas are linked together. And then what will help them to actually find the answer would be to look at the words that come before and after each gap. So what we're doing here is encouraging them to look at the co-text, the text that comes before and after the gap. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I completely agree. Okay. This is, I think, a thorough strategy to use.
Okay. And then, Ivana, we have a question about how much shorter the new paper might be.
In essence, because there was a reduction of the time available for the whole paper, some texts have been shortened somewhat, and in some tasks there are fewer questions than there used to be before. Just like bear that in mind if you are using test preparation materials prior to 2015, because there might be some differences in the remaining tasks because of that. Not in task focus, not in task type, apart from part 6, which is new.
Okay, thank you. An interesting question here, quite a general question, very important. How to motivate students to read? Because as we said in the webinar, it is really important that students read. It's going to be a very important preparation for the test. I think as a teacher, I would say the twin advice from me would be to allow some students an element of choice in terms of what they read. The idea of the book club that we discussed in the webinar, one option being to allow the students to choose the text they read, and maybe each student's reading a different one. So they are very much focusing on the type of thing that interests them personally. And I think that's a big help. In a sense, it doesn't matter what the students are reading to prepare, as long as they are reading widely and reading as a habit. And the second part, I would say, would be not to expect them just to read from cover to cover straight off without any help or support from you. So in other words, you might begin them with shorter texts, or if they are reading a longer text, such as a chapter from a novel or a reader, then you might get them to read in what I would call bite-sized pieces. So they read a chapter, they come in and they talk about it and they do some work on it. And then you get them interested maybe in some prediction work as to what might happen in the next part of the story. And then they go away and read possibly at home in their own time, feeling more motivated to having created the anticipation of what might be coming next. Any other ideas, Ivana, for motivating for reading?
I think this is really good. Mm-hmm. But there were two questions that I actually wanted to pick. One of them is about the timing recommendations for each individual part of reading and use of English. We don't provide timing recommendations by part. You know that you need 1 hour and 30 minutes. You have 1 hour and 30 minutes to read and respond to all the questions in the reading and use of English paper. So it's absolutely up to you and to their students how much time they spend on each part. So the general time management during the test is important, but it's entirely left to the test taker. Another important question is about the scale. If I understood correctly, some students are scared about the introduction of the Cambridge English scale because they think they will be assessed on each and every skill using the scale. Well, this is not correct. Students are still assessed on their overall performance on the exam, so their scores on each individual paper are summed up, and then basically the overall mark, if it is above the pass mark, then basically that's the grounds for passing students or for, you know, awarding a below pass. What is important is that, yes, the new scale provides diagnostic information, so you will get an idea of how well you performed on each paper. But that's for purely diagnostic purposes, so that you and your students know what they should focus on, what they should work more on for the next exam. So an important thing to emphasize is do not focus on getting a certain set of marks on each paper. Focus on teaching students to develop a certain set of language skills and aspects of language ability which are necessary for them to function at C1 level in a university or professional environment, etc. That's the key thing, not working for a particular score on the exam.
Mm. Okay. I'm just looking at a couple of questions that have come through here. Do Cambridge certificates and IELTS ones have the same value? This is from Laurie. Well, of course, IELTS and Cambridge certificates are both administered by Cambridge Assessment, but I think I understand what you're saying because we're talking about a contrast between the main suite and then the standalone IELTS. As a teacher and a trainer, my understanding has always been that it's not a question of which is more valuable, but that they are going to be sat by different profiles of candidates, and they're going to be recognised by perhaps different organisations or bodies. For example, an IELTS candidate will take the test in order probably to go higher into academic education in the UK, in Australia, in the United States and so on. Whereas perhaps the Cambridge main suite is more aimed more broadly before moving on to employment prospects and so on. Would you think that's a good distinction to make?
Well, yes, of course. Main suite candidature are still university students as well. So basically, somebody who does want to study in an English medium environment, they can and should take CAE. So they have options: CAE, IELTS, whatever, whatever they find more suitable.
Mm-hmm. And then. I feel some texts on the advanced test demand a great knowledge. Well, I think what I always remind my students is they're not being tested on their knowledge of, well, let's take from today's webinar an example, the black bears. It's not about your knowledge of black bears. It's your ability to process the message in a text. And I think that will always be the case, whether the text is about rocket science or whatever, that it's going to be about you extracting some basic meaning, whether it's the gist or whether it's specific information from that text. And Cambridge assume that you are a layperson, not an expert on that subject. Do you think that's
I completely comment? Agree. And in relation to this, we had another question asking how to approach and how to tackle the situations when a student provides an intelligent answer to a question, but it's not really based in a text. Well, it's important that actually you provide an answer which is based on your comprehension of the text.
Yes.
You're not tested on your background knowledge, you're not tested on your world knowledge, but simply on your ability to understand the written word in the test.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And then a question, how can I teach my students to read faster, please? Well, this is obviously something that we touched on briefly in the webinar itself, where we were talking about encouraging your students to develop the habit of putting their finger on the first line of the text and then moving that down as they read, to almost drag their eyes, I think that was the expression, to force them not to get hung up on the first line or two of a text, because timing is everything with this test. And I think to add to that, just the general message, you really do not have to understand every word. Again, Cambridge Assessment is not assuming that each candidate will understand all the words in a text. What they're hoping is that the candidate will be able to understand enough to process the message and to tolerate ambiguity, to move across words that they don't understand, to focus on what they do need to understand to answer the questions.
Yes, I agree. We have also been asked about the average reading speed of an advanced reader, and research has shown that, let's say, an average adult, a native speaker, reads a prose text at about 250 to 300 words per minute. Check what your students can do. See how reasonable it is to push them forward within the available time. Let's say, I mean, reading speeds can vary a lot, so you can have something like 500 to 800 words per minute is fantastic. People at reading competitions read at 1,000 words per minute or even higher. But, you know, you have to strike a balance. What is the optimal reading speed for maximum comprehension?
Okay, thank you. And that's all we have time for this morning. Thank you for attending this webinar. I hope you found it useful. The next webinar coming up is Computer-Based Testing for Young Learners, March the 23rd and the 25th. Thank you and goodbye.